How's it going, everyone? Maryland here, and I'm back on the Hermitcraft Feed the Beast server, playing on Monster. Aw yeah, so let's take a look at what I've kind of accomplished. Did a whole bunch of building and stuff off camera, because it's kind of boring, but yeah, I added this little garden thing just right outside, growing some potatoes and some wheat. Some wheat, and yeah, it's pretty nice actually. We're gonna need these potatoes for something though. Now, where on earth did I get the potatoes? Well, thankfully they have some potatoes available at the Hermit Valley thingy over there, so that's pretty cool. So I just kind of used some, and I replanted. Don't worry, and then I planted some over here. So now I got some potatoes going. Also did a bit of reordering things. I got this. It's kind of ugly right now. I'll be moving it later, but it at least gets the job done. We have the dynamo, sending all the power up to the leadstone energy cell. We have the alloy smelter over here. We have the sag mill right here. Item ducts, they send it all into this iron chest, which is just kind of storing some of my ingots and stuff for the meanwhile. And I also have a pulverizer set up here, and the reason for that is I did some enchanting, right? I went over to the Hermit Valley thingy and used the experience farm there, and I made some bronze armor, decided to enchant it. Didn't get the greatest enchantments in the world, but not too bad either. I mean, you know, I'll take it, sure. But my diamond pickaxe, I made a diamond pickaxe. Look at this! Unbreaking 3, Silk Touch 1, and Efficiency 4. First try, that's awesome. And then a Peridot pickaxe that I enchanted as well. Also got Silk Touch and Efficiency, so that's pretty cool. Got Looting 3 on my sword. Efficiency, I mean, you know, pretty good, pretty good. They have those really cool purple crystals over there, which just give you free experience. So you can basically just sit there and receive some experience. Now, it's kind of boring. I didn't feel like showing it, but that's kind of, you know, where I'm at. Let's see. But that's right. I use Silk Touch on some redstone ore. Now, that's how you get the cinnabar stuff. You see, if you put it in a pulverizer, you get 6 redstone, and then you also have a 25% chance of getting the cinnabar if you put the redstone ore in there. I could just put this into my sag mill, but I wouldn't have a chance of getting the cinnabar. I'd get more redstone, but the cinnabar is so nice, because I could use it with an induction smelter later on, and that gives me a lot of extra output. And the most important thing is, if I use it with the ferrous ore here, it'll give me 3 ferrous ingots and a 100% chance of getting that coveted shiny ingot. Which is really good. That's definitely something something worth getting the cinnabar for. So, figured I'd do that. But yeah, I mean, this setup works. And that's why I have the pulverizer here. It came in handy after all. I also have these barrels. These are not the barrels you're probably used to seeing. These are not the factorization barrels. But they're the JABA barrels, which stands for, I think, just another barrel something or another, I don't know. But it is a nice barrel mod. It's pretty much the same recipe even. Let me just take a look here. See, these are the factorization barrels. And they're all right. Let's see, why am I not clicking it? Yeah, you just, some wood and then a slab on top. But this JABA barrel, the better barrel it's called, it's basically the same recipe, except you put a chest in the middle. And apparently you can, like, upgrade it and stuff. I haven't played around with that too much, but this seems to do the trick. And that's fine. Okay, now, here's where I've done a lot of work. Yeah, also you may notice that latest death. Remember last episode where I had that bucket of water and it just kind of spilled? Yeah, I kind of took a trip, like, right after I was recording. It's like, oh, I'm just going to go down and see. Oh, no, and I just fell and died. Oh, that was a little less than fun, let's just say. Oh, so I had to rebuild all these ladders. Yeah, but anyway, I have a second floor here, and I'm starting to move things down here. I don't really have enough iron that I want to invest into making these iron chests. I'm just using double chests for right now, just because I'm lazy. I need to go mining, get some more stuff. But this is kind of nice. And then there's even another floor where I have even more room and even more stuff. Now, what do we have here? This is my Tinker's Construct setup. I actually went over Tinker's Construct in my, what was it, Unleashed video series, which was very short-lived, but I did show building this, so I didn't feel the need to go through everything. Instead, let me just kind of show you what it should look like when it's set up, and we'll just kind of go over the abridged version, or the very basic version. I guess every episode of mine is a bridge, right? It's so crazy. Okay, so all of this was made using one stack of sand, one stack of gravel, and then one stack of clay. In fact, I'm going to go to the Tinker's Construct mod over here and show you what you need. You're going to need this grout stuff, and that's what you make. You make two grout for every one clay, sand, and gravel you put together. Then you have to smelt this, and it turns into seared bricks. With these, you build the components you need in order to build the Tinker's Construct smeltery. So, you need the smeltery controller, probably a smeltery drain or two, and a seared tank. You're definitely going to need those. You're also going to need a lot of seared bricks. Now, one stack was enough to make all of this, and I even made two seared faucets. I just tend to like having two. I don't know why. And seared faucets are not the quickest way to dispense something, but they're just kind of nice because you can right-click it. You could actually use a fluiduct and power it with a redstone signal, like a lever, and that'll work well too. Just take my word on it before you start thinking, oh, wait, you can use that! You can use that! And it's true, you can. Don't worry. So once you have all this stuff, you're going to need to build a little structure here. It needs to have a floor that's 3x3 of seared bricks, okay? And then the edges, doesn't need to have the corners, but just three out, well, yeah, like this. They need to be a combination of seared bricks or any of the other things, such as the smeltery controller, smeltery drain, or the seared tank. If you have it like that, once you have at least one layer here, it's considered a structure, a multi-block structure. Now, the one thing to keep in mind is this smeltery controller, I put it on the edge here, facing outward, because I thought that looked neat, but it said it was an invalid structure. That's because this smeltery controller needs to be facing outwards. Like, you can't have it face here, it had to face outwards on this block instead. So I have it set up right here. Now, what the heck do you do with this anyway? Well, you get to put in ore into the smeltery, or ingots, or anything like that, and it converts it to liquid form. So, in this instance, see all these pretty liquids here? Molten shiny. It's so shiny. So you can take, say, iron, and melt it in the smeltery. For instance, if you have some iron ore, this is actually a good way to double your ore output. Because one iron ore gets you 288 millibuckets worth of molten iron. And then, with this, you can actually craft a whole bunch of different parts for your tools, but you can also convert it to an ingot, and it takes 144 millibuckets to make an ingot. That's pretty nice. So that's an effective way to double your ore output without too much hassle. Basically, every 144 millibuckets is one ingot's worth. So keep that in mind. Anyway, so this melts down your ores into a liquid form. You then pour them out onto either the casting table, or if you're looking for just a block of something, you pour it into the casting basin. The casting basin can be nice for making like glass blocks and stuff, which look really pretty. However, before we can do any of this, we're going to need some lava! Yeah, that's right. We have to put lava in this seared tank here, which sort of serves as fuel. That's the one downside to this, is it does require lava as fuel. But in the big picture, it's not that big of a deal. But it's important to have a good lava source that you can draw lava from. Thankfully, I see on my map over there, there's a nice little pool of lava just to the northeast. So I can probably just go over there and grab some lava there. And on top of this, you're also going to need some stuff to make things. I went ahead and made it all. The stencil table, pattern chest, part builder, and then the tool forge. The tool forge is actually the upgraded version of the tool station. In fact, let me show you these really quick, just so you kind of know. Here's the tool station. It's made just by using a crafting table with this blank pattern. You're going to need a lot of these blank patterns, so get an idea of how they're made. It's just some planks and sticks. Pretty simple. This is used to actually construct your tools. I'm not going to go into that right now, but just take my word on it. I'll show you the whole works in a moment. You're also going to want to have the part builder, which needs a blank pattern and a log. Not a plank, but a log. That gets you the part builder. That's what you use to make different parts of things. And it's useful for, like, crafting things that aren't, like, metal. And things that can become your ingot cast. Because you're actually going to need to make a cast of things. Just, again, to take my word on it, you'll need it. Then a stencil table, which is used to make stencils of stuff. And you use that for, actually, that's what you use these blank patterns for. And then you take the stencils over to the part builder. And that's how you make your parts. So this is just a plank and a blank pattern. Piece of cake. And then this pattern chest stores those patterns, which is also very handy. In order to make that, you just need a chest and another one of those blank patterns. Now the good news is, once you have all this built, it goes pretty easy. Like, it's not really too much of a hassle. I mean, you gotta build some things here and there. I'll show you that, but this is the main stuff you need for the infrastructure. Also, the tool forge, that's right. It takes the tool station, and this is where it gets a little more expensive. It takes 3 seared bricks, which means that's 12 seared individual brick items, you know. And then 4 blocks of iron. So, yeah, it's kind of pricey, but this allows you to make the really cool stuff. You're still going to need a lot of ingots worth of material in order to make it, but definitely worth getting because the second tier items are really nice. Okay, that being said, I need to get some lava in this thing so we can actually get it to work. So how are we going to do that? Well, we could use a bucket. That seems to make the most sense. Except, there's another way. I want to keep my water bucket here. It's always good to have a bucket of water handy. It's like one of my favorite things ever. But I do want to have an empty bucket. Now, I'm not just going to take one bucket at a time, because I'm going to have to go back and get it all the time. That's not cool. Instead, let's make a portable tank. We can do this by just taking some glass and surrounding one copper ingot with that glass. So, let's see, where do I have my glass? Oh, by the way, just in case you were wondering, all of this wall and floor and stuff like that's all made through this chisel item, which I love so much. It's all made using cobblestone. So it's kind of gray right now, but I like that Wizard's Tower sort of feel. I'll probably spruce things up once I do some more mining and get more materials and such. But, oh, and these iron bars, you can chisel those too and make really cool patterns with them. I really like it. All right, so let's take some glass here. And let's find some copper. I think that's still lurking upstairs. Yes, it is. Okay, so we'll do that. And let's take 4 of those. And some copper. Cool. That gets us this portable tank, which we can use to fill with liquids and stuff. Now, I don't have any lava on me right now, but I think, actually, you know what? Before I try to pour a bucket of water, let me shut that door. Actually, you know what? Let me take my crescent hammer here. What makes this nice is you can just shift right click with your crescent hammer, and then that'll pick it up. So that's pretty cool. Just to make sure I don't accidentally break things, I'm gonna go down here. Alright. Actually, I guess I could accidentally break things there, too. Well, gosh darn it, you know what? It'll just have to do. Oh, that's just gonna be a mess. Here's what I'll do. I'll just take some dirt. Alright, there we go. Now we're safe. Alright, so let's do this. And I think if you have a bucket, you can just right-click it, and it'll put something into it. So I can just fill this up with water if I want. I can also right-click and take it out using that. Now, this is probably the most inefficient way to do things, but it is still an option. On top of that, see how there's a blue spot up there and a blue spot down there? Well, you can take your crescent hammer, right-click it, and it'll set to output. The top is always going to be an input, but the bottom, I think, can be set either to input or to output it. And when it's outputting it, you can output the material using like a liquiduct or something. So my goal is I'm going to fill this up with lava using the bucket to take one there and put it there, and then, you know, and then I'll take it with me. That's another thing. The contents remain with you, even if you are taking it around. So I could pick it up with the hammer, and then I'd still take all of the contents of this portable tank with me. So 8,000 millibuckets. That's going to be nice. So you know what? I'm going to go do that. And it's actually almost day out. Now that I have my armor, I don't feel too vulnerable. So I think... Ooh, that was dangerous. Why am I using this? This thing needs to go away. I think I'm going to go and get it myself. Let's put this stuff away for right now. I have my bucket, and I have pretty much everything I need. Oh, and really quick, once you've made the smelting stuff, you'll get these two books, and they're very helpful books. Definitely keep that in mind. Uh-oh, I hear a baby zombie. I hear a baby zombie. I need more torches. That's what I need. All right, what the heck? All right, there we go. Where are you, baby zombie? I'll fight you. Oh, what is that thing? Reaver. Leave it to Reaver. All right, this isn't too bad. Oh, slow. Hey, get out of here. Huh. Thing's kind of creepy. All right, so I guess since it's day out, I don't have too much to worry about. Let's just go grab that lava. I guess there's no point in cutting here. So obviously I don't want to burn myself. So let's just get a little closer. Okay. Pig! Watch out, buddy! You could burn. Alright, let's set up the... Where is my tank? Oh, pig! Pig, you're getting up in my business, pal. Alright, we got a portable tank here. Now, let's hope this works. There we go. Pig, you're gonna mess this up. Alright, so we got 2,000 millibuckets. 3,000. Let's see. We can just fill it up like this. Alright, all full. So, just take that and go. Now, this lake is not going to last forever. It's just a tiny little surface lake. But, for now, it'll be just fine. If you need lava, you can also just kind of tunnel down, find some under the ground. But, hey, that surface one's just so convenient. Okay, so, let me just go up here, and let's put that tank there. And I'm actually going to switch it so it's an output mode. Should output right onto this thing. Now, if you get all fancy and use ender tanks later on, and they're super convenient, too. This is an ender tank, and it takes blaze rods, obsidian, a cauldron, and an ender pearl. And I'm having just a pain getting these ender pearls. I don't have any. Haven't run to any endermen yet. Otherwise, I would totally put an elevator here. That'd be awesome. But I don't have any yet, so it's just going to have to wait. But ender tanks are really nice because they link up and stuff. So, I don't know. I'm getting a bit ahead of things there, but just keep that in mind. Okay, now watch this. See, its mode is input. Right-click it with the crescent hammer. and it'll turn to output. So see, we filled up the seared tank with lava. This thing now, it has some extra lava in it, so it'll output it as this runs out. And then once this runs out, I can just take the tank with me, refill it in that lava pool, and we're good to go. So now we get to put some stuff in the smeltery. So there's a lot of different things we can make in here. I'm going to go over this materials and you book. This shows you the different tools. I'm not going to go over all of these. Instead, I recommend just kind of reading through everything to get an idea of what it is. And man, this font looks awful at this size. Oh my goodness, it's so bad. Oh, I wish it would scale a little bit better. But anyway, after all of the different tools, it also shows you the different materials and different traits. So, you know, there's like iron and stone. You can make stone tools, and it's kind of nice too. But alumite is pretty good. It's like your top level before going into the nether. Once you've gone into the nether, though, cobalt and ardite are also very good, as is manuin. You can also make, like, steel tools and stuff. But yeah, anyway, I like this pink alumite. Having a pickaxe out of that wouldn't be too shabby. So we're going to need to make something for that. Now, in order to make a pickaxe, again, this tells you what you need. You need a pickaxe head, a tool rod, and a tool binding in order to make that. Well, that's pretty cool. So let's go ahead and figure out how to do that. So first things first, we need to make sure we have some gold. Or, what is it? Brass aluminum, I think it is. Brass something or another. Aluminum brass. Let me look this up really quick. Let's see. Because you're going to need to make these cast things. Aluminum brass. That's it. And that's made by smelting copper and aluminum. Now, I prefer to save my aluminum for alumite early on at this point. To make alumite in the smeltery, you need to take 720 millibuckets aluminum with 288 iron, 288 obsidian. And that gets you a lot of molten alumite. So that's pretty cool. But you're going to need to make these blank casts. And that can be made using either molten aluminum brass or molten gold will do it. So it depends on what you have more of. Thankfully, aluminum is easier to get, it seems, nowadays. I have plenty. Well, I have 28. That's an all right amount, but it's not perfect. So I think I'm actually going to use some gold here. And in order to make these casts, which I'll kind of show you how this works, you're going to need some gold. In fact, I should probably cook some up right now. Have that kind of going in the background here. All right, love that alloy smelter. It's so cool. All right, don't need anything there. But let's go down here. Oh, you know what? I should really grab some iron and obsidian. Darn it, what's the matter with me? Oh, well. Okay, let's see here. Let's get some obsidian and some iron. I want to make a pink pickaxe. Oh, yeah, you heard me. You heard me. Whoa, all right. I got to do something about this. I want an elevator so bad. Oh, my goodness. Okay, so in here, let's say we want to smelt this aluminum. Just, you can hold in, left click, and do that, and it works just fine. And then there's a little progress bar. And then once it's all melted, it'll be in this smeltery, it'll just be in the smeltery. In fact, you can even see it starting to melt all this stuff here, which is cool. Now, let's say you wanted to have more stuff you could cook here at a time. Right now, I can only cook 9 blocks at a time because my smeltery is only 1 block high. You could go ahead and add another layer of seared bricks, and that would increase the amount of stuff you can smelt at any given time. You can actually put up to 18 then if you had 2 layers, 27 if you had 3 layers, and so on and so forth. So if you do a lot of smelting, keep that in mind. You can just make this thing go like way high up and smelt a lot more. And that's pretty nice. But for right now, 9 is fine. Okay, so this is going to smelt and give me some molten aluminum. And it says I have 18 ingots worth. Well, that's really nice. So, if I wanted to make... Oh, darn it, you know what? I need to make the cast before I can do anything with that. So, two options here. I could either go ahead and pour out the two pour out all of this into two aluminum blocks using this casting basin. Or I could also, in fact, I think I'm going to do this. Let's go ahead and melt all of this gold, or at least 9 gold. Because you can actually do something in newer versions of Tinker's Construct, which I'll show you in a moment. But anyway, right now, I'm also going to need some planks, darn it. I need some wood. Gotta get some wood. Alright, do I have it in here yet? I am going to need a lot more than that. I guess I'll take what I got. Thankfully, I started growing a whole bunch of trees outside. Okay, there we go. Potatoes. Potatoes are really nice. Not only are they great if you eat them as a baked potato, but they're also really useful for Tinker's Construct. I know, right? What would you use a potato for? Well, I'll show you in a moment. Don't worry. Okay, so we're going to need to make some parts for this because we're going to be able to make the cast, but if you just pour your gold or your aluminum brass onto a casting table, it'll give you that blank cast, which, let's face it, that isn't going to do you much good. You need to have something placed onto the casting table and then pour the gold or aluminum brass around it. And then that'll make something. So we're going to need several things here. We're going to need a pickaxe head. We're going to need a tool binding and a tool rod. At least if we wanted to make a pickaxe. So let's go ahead and I'm going to need some sticks here. Let's do this. I think I'll need several. All right, so let's make 4 blank patterns. That'll do for now. What do we do with these blank patterns? Well, we go over to the stencil table here, and you can just place them there. Now, this will make you whatever it shows here if you left-click it. However, you're probably not just going to want to make tool rods all day. I mean, come on, what would that be about? Instead, you can just press Next Pattern or Previous Pattern, and it'll allow you to scroll through all of the different patterns that you can make. It also tells you the material cost in making that. That means this would take 3 ingots worth in order to make this once it's all set. This would take 3. This would take 8. Now, those are the tier 2 ones, mind you. The lower tier ones, like this pickaxe I want to make, it won't require too much. So let's start with that. Let's make a pickaxe head pattern. Let's make a tool rod pattern. And then let's make a tool binding pattern, I think it is. It's the one that looks like an X. And we'll just leave that there. Cool thing is, with these patterns, you can put them inside of the pattern chest and then just use them from this part builder, as long as it's adjacent. Alright, so what do I do now, right? Well, if you're making your material, or like your pickaxe, out of anything kind of lightweight, I guess, like stone, wood, cactus, flint, I mean, anything like that, you can actually just make it by using this pattern here. Let's see. Actually, let's take this pickaxe. See, I can put 1 cobblestone there, and then it'll let me make a stone pickaxe head. You can't do this with any metals like that. And I can put it there, but it's not going to work. You need to use the metal cast for it, which is made right here. So in this case, in order to do that, I need to first make a stone pickaxe head. Ta-da! I made one. It doesn't consume the pattern, which is really nice. We're also going to need to make a tool rod pattern and another thing. Why? Well, this is why. See, we place it by right-clicking it onto the casting table. Then, inside of here, we need to pour either molten gold or molten aluminum brass onto it. and then that'll form a cast. But if I were to try pour anything right now, it would try to pour the aluminum. And that doesn't work. I need aluminum brass. Well, I could either pour out all of my aluminum into this casting basin and then pour the gold, or you can actually left-click now and reorder it. Whatever you left-click will be pushed to the bottom here, and then you can right-click it, and it should work. There we go. See, now we're pouring some gold onto this, and we get the pickaxe head cast. Very cool. So what do we do with this? Well, you can't take this to the part builder and put something on it. No, it doesn't work like that. But hopefully you figured it out by now if you're not familiar with it. You would place it here, and then when we had a metal that we wanted to form into it, we pour it into this cast. So ideally, once we have this aluminum set up so it's alumite, we'll then pour the alumite into this casting table with this cast here. So then it'll form an alumite pickaxe head. That's pretty cool. Okay, so let's go ahead and try that out. What do you say? Except we're going to need to make some more stuff. So I need some cobblestone. For goodness sakes, where's my cobblestone? Do I have any cobblestone here? I think this stuff might work for cobblestone. Hopefully. let's see. All right, so we need a tool rod pattern, which I have there. Ah, darn it, I need the real stuff. All right, no problem. I got plenty of it. Just gonna put that away. All right, there we go. Okay, let's see. So back here, we're gonna put that there, and we're gonna get actually a stone shard. Since this only requires half a material worth, you end up with a shard because, you know, you get that and then half is left over. So this will actually let me make the tool binding pattern, which is pretty nice. So let's take the stone tool rod and the stone shard. We can put this back into the pattern chest, take the tool binding pattern, and put that stone shard there to get the stone binding. Now at this point, I could make a stone tool if I wanted, but before I do that, I should probably get the casts for the other things. So let's take the stone tool rod there, pour a little bit from the molten gold, and then voila, I've got a tool rod cast. And of course, let's go ahead and do that for the stone binding as well. Ta-da! Now that used up, let's see, I got 3 ingots of gold left. So it used up a bit making that. I put 9 in there, so kind of a shame, but that's sometimes how it goes. But on the bright side, I at least have all the stuff I need to make that. Now, I might want to make something else, like a sword or an axe or something, or a shovel. Actually, a shovel's a pretty good option. So I already have everything I'd need for the shovel, except for the shovel head, I'm pretty sure. See this red book? You use it a lot. Actually, yeah, just a shovel head. I don't even need a binding for it. And then making a sword isn't a bad idea, so I might want to make, some kind of a sword. Rapiers are pretty nice. They get around, armor, which is very handy, since a lot of mobs and monsters use armor now. And then this is the tier 2 stuff, which I want to get to at some point, but I don't have the material at this moment. So let's go over to the stencil table. And let's make a shovel head pattern. Then we're going to take that over here and make a stone shovel head. Put that there, pour a little gold, and we'll have a shovel head cast, which we can use to make shovels. The good news is you don't have to worry too much about doing this stuff all the time. Let's see. So that used up 2 ingots. That's kind of a shame, but that's how it goes. I'd probably best. In fact, let me actually see. One other really nice thing to do is make an ingot cast right away. So let's see if I have enough. Oh, I don't quite have enough. And this is what really stinks. If you don't have enough it just gets kind of awkward. Like, I'd need to break this table in order to get rid of that molten gold. So I'm just going to melt another gold ingot really quick and then pour the rest out. Apparently the casts take two molten gold or molten alumite, or not alumite, aluminum brass in order to make the cast. Okay, but you know what? While that's doing its thing, I don't need this stuff anymore. So let's make a tool with it. Over here, you'll see all the tools that you can make. If you're only using a tool station, you won't see any of the second tier stuff, which is all this stuff right here. It requires a lot if you're making a second tier tool, but they're really cool. Particularly the hammer and the axe and this thing, although they're all really great. Hammer is, like, way overpowered, though. But if you just want to make, like, a standard pickaxe, just select it from the tab over here. And then just put the parts there, and you'll make it. Now, this is the most basic stone pickaxe you could get. But it's still not too shabby, actually. And the nice thing is, it won't break permanently. You can repair it by just taking it back to the tool forge and putting some cobblestone there. Now, ideally, you'll want to give it different materials, as opposed to just making it out of alumite, because that'll get you different enchantments and stuff. Or not really enchantments, but you can basically give different properties to things, different modifiers. So really quick here, if you look at the modifiers, there's a lot of really cool modifiers. That's way further back. Like in this instance, adding a diamond to it increases its mining level to 3, which means it can mine diamonds and obsidian and stuff, which can be cheap if you don't want to waste your diamonds on a diamond pickaxe. Sometimes just doing this so you can get the obsidian you need to do stuff isn't that bad of an option. The really good ones are speed, which is very nice. It uses redstone. Auto repair can be good, but ultimately I really recommend... where is it? See, look at all these. Oh, there we go. Flux. This basically allows you to recharge your tool using redstone flux, which is awesome. It's really awesome. And you can add additional modifiers. Now, what's really nice about this is you're really best making a paper binding for it if you're using a tool like that, because I think only the head really has that much of an impact on stuff. All right, so I got the ingot cast, and I got the aluminum there. Let's go ahead and smelt up some iron really quick, and then some obsidian. All right, so we got this. And like, for instance, if I were to put this here, I could add something to it. I think obsidian, no, obsidian doesn't do anything. What could I add to it? Okay, let me put it to you this way. What do I have right here, right now? Oh, I don't want to waste too much time on it, really. It's just a stone pickaxe. Oops, I didn't want to get in this book. Oh well, I mean, hopefully you at least get the idea there. Well, I'll tell you what, I'm going to wait for this to finish smelting, and once I get some alumite, I'll be set. Although I do want to get some paper, because the paper binding is really good. If you use a paper binding for like a pickaxe or something, it gives you an extra slot that you can use to like add a modifier, which is very handy. So you'll burn through those pretty quickly. So having paper is a good thing to have. Let me go ahead and make some paper really quick here. I don't want to use all my sugar cane up, but 3 paper should be fine. Now, this is something that I would actually make in the part builder. I take the tool binding pattern, and I put some paper there. One thing to keep in mind with paper, it, like, one sheet of paper is half of a material. So if you wanted to make, say, a pickaxe head out of paper, you'd actually need, oh, actually, what, more? Yeah, I don't know, it's more expensive than you'd think, so just kind of keep that in mind. In this instance, it's just fine. I can just make a paper binding and be set. But I know in the past I've run into it requiring way more paper than I thought I would need. So that's kind of a shame. All right, let's go ahead and melt some obsidian. This takes forever to melt, though. Ugh. It's going to be a nightmare. But I at least have the paper binding. That's pretty cool. Probably wouldn't hurt to have another one. I'll probably make a shovel, too. All right, I'm just going to let this smelt really quick. And I will see you once that's done. Okay, so all set here. We have quite a little smorgasbord of different molten stuff in here, but most importantly, we have the alumite. 9 ingots of it, so that should be more than enough to make a pickaxe head and even a tool rod. Now, I think you could actually give it a different tool rod if you wanted. It would cut into its durability a bit, but a stone tool rod would give it the, the stonebound modifier kind of built in, which means as its durability runs lower, its mining speed increases. Now, since I want to actually give it the flux modifier to have it run off of redstone flux, that could be kind of nice. But I don't know. It's not really that big of a deal. And I don't know. I mean, I guess we'll try it. Sure, why not? Let's just go for it. Okay, so to do that, we just need that. And we don't even need to pour this tool rod cast. We can just use this stone tool rod here. And that should do it. So now all we need is this pickaxe head cast. And that should hopefully do the trick. So do that. It'll take 1 ingots worth of alumite, and ta-da, we got the alumite pickaxe head. Now, we can actually go ahead and see if this is what we want. So let's select this, put the alumite pickaxe head there, the paper binding there, and then, oops, I have this thing there, that's odd. Ta-da, so this will allow me to mine at the cobalt level, which means I can mine obsidian with this. The mining speed is 8, and it has 4 modifiers remaining. It has a durability of 275, so that's pretty cool. However, I don't see it having the stonebound modifier. I think that might only be for the binding, perhaps. One way to find out. Let me just try that. Trying to remember here. Oops, let's see. I guess I don't even get it there. But, as you see, by switching the binding out, it doesn't affect anything except for the modifiers remaining. So I'd be best giving it the paper binding. It's nice that it shows you all the different stats over here. There we go. See, it does say stonebound. I'm sorry. For some reason, I was thinking it shows up over there. See, over here it says stonebound, writable, and reinforced. So that stonebound is really handy. Now, I'm not opposed to making an alumite tool rod. Let's just see how it affects things. So let's take the tool rod cast here, and let's just pour a little bit out. This uses up 1/2 an ingot's worth, so keep that in mind if you're trying to pour things out. Let's see. So we'll go to the tool forge, and we see all that stuff over there. If we give it the alumite tool rod, as you can see, the mining speed remains the same. And the mining level remains the same, but the durability goes up substantially. But it doesn't have the stonebound modifier. So, since durability doesn't really matter if you're going to make it flux-powered, this is a good kind of starting one to go with. So let's just go with that. Now, before you click this and make it, you can actually give it a name. So I'm going to name it the, what should I name it? How about the Pretty Pink Pick? There we go. All right, we got the Pretty Pink Pick. So before I add too much to it, let's just test this thing out. What do you say? I'm just going to dump most of that stuff into that chest just for right now. So I think I'll take the miner's backpack with. All right, let's fall. Want to get one of those things. All right, and let's see how this thing goes. Now, the nice thing is it won't break. Fully. Once it runs out of its durability here, it doesn't actually, like, break. It just requires repairing, and you need to repair it with the material that the tool head is made out of. So in this instance, I'd need to repair it using some alumite ingots. And you can do that over in the tool forge thingy. So this is my little strip mine thing I set up. It's very basic. But let's just take a look here at how well this thing will work. Remembering I don't have any torches, darn it. Oh, well. Wow, I really don't. That is so weird. All right. Ooh, yeah. Goes pretty quick. I mean, it's not like super duper quick, but it's not too shabby either. And since, you know, I can repair it just using some alumite, that's pretty awesome. All right, let's see. I really need some coal right now. Oh my goodness. Can't see for anything. But you know what? I think we get a basic idea here. Now, the idea is we want to actually run this out of its durability, or at least get it down to 1% of its durability. As low as possible. We want it to have one use left. And then we apply the modifier to it. So, you know what? I'm going to go just mining really quick. Just to do that. And I will see you in a moment, guys. Okay, so I've gone ahead and weakened my new pretty pink pick. And I want to now add that flux modifier to it. So if you're looking in here in the materials and you thing, you'll see it'll take one of those flux thingies or one of those energy cells. But that's kind of expensive. I mean, you know, I mean, it's not that bad. You could use lead ingots and copper and some sulfur to make one of these. This is like a portable thing that you can take with you. That's actually kind of neat. Or you could also use, what is it, an energy cell? Which, you know, let's face it, they're kind of, I mean, they're not too bad, but yeah, it's going to take some stuff. You could do that, or this is where the potato comes in, everyone. You can actually just power it with potatoes. That's right. You see, you don't actually have to use one of those things. You can, at least, I'm pretty sure you still can. I know you used to be able to. Just make a little tiny potato thing. So you're going to need some lead nuggets. You need one lead nugget, one piece of redstone, and a potato. And that gets you a fully powered tuberous flux capacitor. This thing only stores 16,000 RF. So, you know, it doesn't store very much, and it can't even receive anything. It sends 20 RF per tick. It's not all that great, but you can use this to add the flux modifier. So actually, we can just go right here, and we'll take that pretty pink pick, put it, I think, put it here, and see, we get a little 0.93 bonus. It has one durability left, which is exactly what we want. And then we just put the tuberous flux capacitor there, and ta-da, it turns into a pretty pink pick with flux. And it even comes with 16,000 RF. Now the good news about this is Stonebound still triggers, but we can recharge this thing, which is so cool. However, how on earth are we going to recharge it? Well, let's just go up to that redstone, I guess it's a leadstone energy cell. And let's just slap it in there. What do you say? Oh, wait. There's nowhere to put it inside of this thing. So how do you charge it? What do you do? Well, you actually have to make another machine called the Energetic Infuser. I already went ahead and got everything set up for it. It's all stuff that you should be familiar with by now. The leadstone energy cell frame, machine frame, transmission coils, two of them actually, and a reception coil, and then some copper gears. So it's not that bad, but it definitely takes a bit. So that gets you the Energetic Infuser. And this is what you use if you want to charge any of your tools or things like that. It can also be used to charge those flux capacitor things here, which are like kind of portable flux thingies that I guess let you recharge tools like this, or your RF tools here, but I don't know. I always kind of find them kind of cumbersome. Now, let's see. Where do I want to set this thing up? I guess it doesn't really matter. Let's just put it here. It's going to drain a lot of RF from my system, so I should probably get it all set up. Let me just feed it some more coal. I'm gonna need. Oh, darn it. You know what? Can't open this chest now. you know what? Before this starts draining too much more, I'll find a better spot for it. But for right now, we'll just put it there. Now, this does have inputs and outputs, so it is automatable, if you want to use that word. You know, pretty basic stuff. But anyway, let's put this pretty pink pick in there. You put something in there, and then it will charge using redstone flux. That's right. Now, this is actually receiving 80 RF per tick, but it's only outputting to this tool 75 RF per tick. So that's kind of a shame. Depending on what you're using and what you're charging in this energetic infuser, the amount that's being sent may vary. See, it charge rate may be limited by the item. Feel the hum. yeah, so this is charging that up pretty good. I need to put some coal in here, though. Probably more than one piece of coal, though. Because it can store up to 400,000, both the energetic infuser itself and this pretty pink pick. So this isn't exactly the bulkiest power supply in the world, but it'll get the job done at least, so that's good. That's good, and then I can recharge this thing whenever I want. And instead of using durability, it just uses RF, which is so nice. And the fact that you can just make those little tuberous flux capacitors left and right means it's super easy to make a whole bunch of really cool tools that are all RF powered and not even that expensive to add that addition to. So nice. Let's see. So yeah, that's pretty neat. But it doesn't end there. There are some other really cool modifiers you can add. In fact, let me just go to this materials and you thing. I'm not going to waste too much more time on it. But just ones to kind of watch out for, good things. Auto smelt, very cool. This actually smelts things automatically if you put it on a pickaxe. Very cool, because it'll turn like your ores into ingots right away, and it will smelt things like glass and stuff, which is really cool. If you make like a shovel, even a stone shovel, with that, that's a great way to get glass really quickly if you put the recharge thing, the tuberous flux capacitor. Luck is really nice. It just takes a little bit of lapis, and then you'll put luck on it. Now, this adds fortune depending on how high of a level luck is, but doesn't start out too much right away. It does actually increase over time, so it's not that bad to put on a tool right away. And then over time, even if you're not using it for a lot, you can still get a rather high fortune enchantment on it. Or looting if you put it on a sword. Silky is nice. It gets you silk touch on a pickaxe, which is pretty cool. The downside is it requires an emerald and a lot of string. You got to make the silky cloth, four of those, and then wrap it around an emerald. So it's not exactly the easiest thing in the world to do. But, you know. And then if you need more modifiers, you could get another star, or you could get a diamond and a gold block. That gets you one additional modifier if you want. Let's see. So how's my tool doing? You know what? That's fine enough. Okay, so we have this thing here. Let's go ahead and give it a little bit of luck and a little bit of redstone for haste. That'll speed it up. Whoops. Drop down here. Okay, so we're going to put that right in here, and then we're going to put some lapis there. Now, this won't give it fortune right from the get-go. You need to actually add a lot to it if you wanted fortune. It's probably going to take about 50, I think, 50 lapis total. But this number here actually increases the more you use it. So that's kind of handy. Now, I could turn these into blocks if I wanted to go a little faster, but unfortunately, you can only do like two of those at a time, so that's kind of a shame. Alright, let's put two there and two there. Now, see, it still doesn't say fortune. It would say fortune once it actually has that, so I think we're going to need going. Yeah, it doesn't have fortune yet, but it will have fortune soon, and that's fine. Now, on top of that, we can also speed it up in a similar way, except by using redstone. So let's just go ahead and take, I don't know, I'll give it some redstone. Certainly doesn't hurt. I'll probably be using this for a while, and that will actually speed it up. See, now the mining speed's up to 11.81. And now it's up to 12.53. And yeah, that's pretty good. Now, once it hits 50, so you can put 50 redstone onto it, and then it maxes out. However, you could actually start over with a second haste enchantment to get even more. Here, let me show you what I mean. I don't know if, let's see, one modifier remaining. I don't want to put Silk Touch or too much else on this. I'll probably just put haste on it. So for instance, let me just take some more redstone. I'm going to have to actually take it out of here. There we go. Put some more redstone on it, and I'll show you what I mean. I don't think it works that way with luck, though. Sorry. All right, so, see, also, it has 49 right now, so it's not going to work. But, see, this will add a second level to it, and it will allow it to continue growing, which is very nice. This pick will become very fast if I just add, you know, about a stack's worth on it. I don't think I'll need all of this. I'm just going to go for two. Let's see. See, we got to take away a block. Ta-da! Now we're all set. Okay, let's see how quickly this thing tears blocks apart. And remember, it uses RF. It has the flux modifier. So we can recharge it whenever we want. Isn't that so nice? I love that. It's great. I don't want to go all the way down to the basement. See, that's not too shabby here. Certainly quick enough. It's not like turbo mode, but, you know, for some pretty basic materials, it's not that bad. This really wasn't too expensive to make by any means. And, yeah, that's nice that we have... a tool that we can recharge whenever we want without having to worry about it. And trust me, this 400,000 lasts a long time. It just seems to go on for just ages. And you know what? I'm going to get rid of that latest death thing here. Going to go to waypoints, and I'm just going to delete that. It's just getting on my nerves. There we go. There we go. Yeah, so hopefully that kind of gives you a nice basic rundown of Tinker's Construct. I know I probably didn't give the abridged version like I was hoping, but it explains enough to get a really nice tool going early on. And hopefully lay the groundwork for some of the other stuff. I'm looking forward to making some of these tier 2 things, which are awesome. But I'm going to need to do some caving first. And now that I have the capacity to make some awesome tools for caving, and I have some armor... and a much bigger base, I'm all set. So anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed, and I will see you on the next episode of Maryland's Hermitcraft Feed the Beast Adventure. See ya next time, smelteries. Yeah!